Saturday, everybody. Boy, Big Brandoh, and welcome to another episode of Bullshit with Brandoh. Now, I want to shout out everybody who left some positive feedback on the first episode. That was just really a trial phase for myself, just to see if this thing was going to, you know, work with my subscribers, work with what I was already doing on YouTube. And I thought it would be a good way for me to share my story with everybody else in a long format, and also eventually get some other business and brand owners in here and have them share their stories with you guys too. That's the ultimate goal with doing this. So I just wanted to start off by actually sharing some of my story with you guys. Now, just to recap what we went through on the last episode, I kind of gave you guys a rundown on my intro to screen printing, how I figured it out, from me actually meeting Mr. Park to actually learning the process on how to screen print and just having my mind blown on the whole process. Now, when I pretty much ended the last episode or last podcast, I was kind of letting you guys know that Mr. Park was pretty much not doing good in business, and he was planning on going out of business. So he gave me the heads up, and what he did was just said, hey, take your screens. I'm going to be printing, but I'm going to be printing out of a small shop, which is like a garage space in Koreatown. If you wanted to still do business, prices would be the same, but it's not going to be as close to you anymore, where you could just ride your bike and do business this way. You would pretty much have to take the bus or get a ride out there, which is cool. You know what I mean? But for myself, convenience and accessibility was something that I was more interested in. So I was looking for other screen print shops in my area. Went back to the phone book, started calling people up. The thing that sucked was Mr. Park was really hooking me up. $2 for a t-shirt. I was getting wholesale prices without having a wholesale license, and $1 a print, which was cool for what I thought. You know what I mean? I just thought that was a cheap price, decent price. And when I was calling a lot of these other shops, I was getting quotes on 100 t-shirts, but the quotes were for like $350 a shirt, or some of them like $4 a shirt. Even if I was already providing the screens, these are the prices I was getting. And they were telling me to supply my own shirt, or I would have to pay, I wouldn't be getting a wholesale rate on the t-shirt. So all of this combined made for just, you know, not good business in my eyes. You know what I mean? It would have been a lot more of an investment for me to get stuff done. And I really wasn't selling too many of these shirts. I was just creating just to create, and it would have been a waste of money. So light bulb goes off in the head, and I'm like, hey, Mr. Park showed me how to do everything. Why not just print from home? You know what I mean? So in the garage, I wanted to get a full setup like what I seen Mr. Park have. But I didn't understand how expensive all that shit was at the time. You know what I mean? So the first thing I did was I hit up Mr. Park. And I just said, hey, I want to actually learn how to print, and I want to print from home. Mr. Park said, here's a bunch of shirts. Bring one of your screens in. Do it on your own. You know what I mean? No supervision, whatever. We're already shutting down. We're breaking walls down. We're pretty much moving stuff out of here. So do whatever you want. Clean up as you go. But you know how to do it. If you want to operate this way, go for it. He actually gave me a shitload of t-shirts. And now most of my shirts were all white, and then I was printing with black. These were different color shirts. I was actually using white inks. And what I didn't understand was when I would do a pass with from a screen. All right, let me just backtrack a little bit. Now, the screen printing process, after the screen's burned and you put it onto, you know, this was on a carousel. I think it had like 6 or 8 colors, so you could put 6 or 8 screens on there. And I think it had 3 or 4 shirt platens where you load the shirt up on the bottom. I think that's how it was. After you load the shirt on, you would spray this adhesive to get the platen tacky, so the shirt didn't slide around. So you'll spray that on, it'll make it pretty sticky. Then you load the shirt on. Now you have the screen locked into place through the clamps. You bring it down. The way he taught me was you flood the screen with ink, meaning before you lay the screen down, you would flood it with ink. So you would cover the whole screen with ink, and then you would lay down the screen on top of the t-shirt. And from there is where you would actually push with the squeegee the ink through the screen onto the t-shirt. This is how I seen him and his workers do it when I would watch them do my t-shirt. So I said, oh, this is easy. What I didn't know was printing white ink on a dark color shirt was not that easy. So he gave me a bunch of shirts. I would say maybe like 60 to 70 shirts, random sizes, random brands. It was just whatever he had laying around, and it was just for practice. So I load my screen up, I put the ink on there, and I'm getting ready to go. I flood the screen exactly like he told me, and then I laid it down, and one passed through. I lift up the screen, and I could still see the shirt through the print. It wasn't opaque. It didn't cover all the way, and I didn't know what the hell was going on. So I did the same process again. I flooded the screen again, laid it down, and pushed it again, pulled it up. This time when I pulled it up, I pulled up a bunch of ink. I pulled up a lot of stuff because now I flooded too much ink in the screen. I pushed it all the way through. Now it's mushy on the shirt, and it kind of spread out through. There's a lot of ink, and when I offset the screen from the t-shirt, it pulled the ink up on the back side of the screen. So it made for like little peaks and mountains in the print. It looked really bad. The edges weren't sharp. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. This was almost a deal breaker for me. I don't want to say that I was ready to give up, but I do want to say that seeing that, I thought to myself, this isn't as easy as these dudes made it seem. But what I didn't understand was when you do black on white, it's a lot easier. It's just, you know, you could go really light when you flood the screen. You could do a really light pass, and black is going to show up on white really, really well. It's different for white to show up on black. So obviously, Mr. Park's homie, his coworker, I don't know if it was a family member or what, told me, nah, this is how you do it. And he did it in two passes, and it came out really good, but it was all in the offset. But what he did teach me, and which was really crazy because I learned two different techniques in this same maybe like week span of learning, was he stacked up two nickels on the edge of where the screen comes down and where it meets the platen. So he had these two nickels on there stacked up. That was just enough offset to get a little bit of bounce in the screen when you pass through, so the screen will bend down and then pop back up because of the offset from the nickels, which was a really, I don't know, like he probably learned that trick from years of printing. I don't know. So he was just showing me his tips and techniques on how he does white ink on a dark color t-shirt, which helped a lot. But that little technique, it wasn't for everybody. You know what I mean? So Mr. Park showed me a different way where he just balled up some masking tape and then he stuck it onto where the screen frame meets up with the platen. And he had just enough tape on there to give it that same offset, I guess you could say. These are little tips that I had no idea about, but it was just something that they passed along, which was really dope. So he showed me how to do it in two passes. He also showed me how to do one pass, you flash dry it, and then you bring the screen down again and you do another pass to get an opaque print. This was cool. Really good learning experience. But for myself, I said, cool, man, I'm going to get me one of these 6 to 8 screen carousels. I'm going to have it set up at the house. I didn't think about where I was going to wash the screens. I didn't think about how I was going to burn screens. I just thought, let me get in this motherfucker and load up my own screen. Excuse me. Load up my own screens. And then I'm going to be banging out t-shirts from the house. That would have been all cool. You know what I mean? There would have been no issues there. So I tell Mr. Park, in my head, I'm thinking, oh, he's going to be like, man, just take my screen printing press, man. And I thought we had a cool relationship. That wasn't the case, man. I said, hey, so what's up, man? How can I buy this machine off you? He said, no, I'm going to keep this. I'm taking this to my garage or my new workspace. I'm still going to be operating. So I said, how can I do this from home? He said, get you a single color press or one single station. And he told me a spot in downtown LA, which was on Main Street at the time. I don't know if that place is still there, but I know you could buy screens from the same place. But I had bought a single color station from there. It pretty much came with its own little stand, which was cool, but you could take it off its stand and put it on a tabletop. It was a dope setup. So he hooked me up with this place. He said, go over there. He said, asked them for some used stuff. He said, you don't have to buy it brand new. If you're going to buy it brand new, you're looking at like $300. He said, if you're buying it used, you're looking at like 80 bucks. So I said, oh shit, 80 bucks. I could do that all day long. So myself, I go down downtown LA. I'm on Main Street. I've never been down in this area before. I'm just south of the 10 freeway. Currently, McLogan is over there. There's a few other suppliers and places down there. South of the 10 freeway, you could get embroidery done. There's sewing machines. There's a lot of screen print shops, embroidery shops. There's a ton of shops that will produce your product down here. So I go over here, check it out, and I ask the dude, hey, you know what? I got this referral from another screen printer, told me to come down and see if you guys had any used equipment. The dude had a gang of used equipment. So I said, I just need a single color station. And he was like, oh, I got a bunch of them. So he showed me all the used ones, all the new ones. The one he showed me and the one that I ended up buying was only 50 bucks. So he said, this is what it is. It comes with this stand. All you got to do is put your screens in and you're good to go. And that's it. So I said, all right, fuck it. 50 bucks. Let's do it. Loaded that sucker up, went home. I said, man, I'm in business. I got all my screens at the garage, and I'm just going to be buying t-shirts from the swap meet, and we're just going to get this thing moving. You know what I mean? So for myself, I said, all right, I'm going to start out slow, but I'm also going to promote and tell people what I'm doing. I'm going to tell people that I'm printing shirts from the house now. I could print their shirts. I could do this, and I was just going to be in business, right? So I had all my screens. At this time, I knew which ones were popular or which ones kind of sold and got good attention and which ones didn't do so well. So the ones that actually I've sold before, some of the designs that I did and some of the designs people asked me about, is one of the ones I went forward with and just said, hey, I can make this shirt for you in, you know, a black shirt with white print, white shirt with black print, blah, blah, blah. And I had, you know, gallons of ink. I had all, what I thought I had was all my supplies. I had a squeegee. I had some solvents to clean the screens out because this is something that Mr. Park told me I needed to do, was make sure no ink dries on the screen or else the screen's going to be rendered useless. So I had, I forget the solvent name, but that shit stunk like crazy. And I remember he would always tell me to use rubber gloves when I was doing it. And the one time that I didn't, I don't know if it was like an acetone. I'm not sure what it was, but it left my hands really dry. But the smell stayed on my hands for a long ass time, like for hours after I did it. It was crazy. But so I had the solvents. I had a squeegee. I had two things of ink. I had black ink and white ink. And I thought I was in business. Same thing. Go down to Gardena Swap Meet, to the indoor swap meet, or to Discount Priceland. And I was buying like the 3 for $9 t-shirts. They might have been AAA. They might have been B-grade AAA shirts. I don't know. But these are the ones that I was buying. And I just thought I was in business. So I sold a few and I was doing decent. But it was setting everything up and then cleaning everything up, which I didn't understand. I was just like, man, this is dumb. Like, I'm going to... Obviously, I wanted to print. So I would set everything up, put the ink in there, and I'm pressing and kind of practicing, but at the same time, I'm pressing shirts. Whether I do one or two shirts or I do 10, the setup and cleanup was the exact same, right? So this is something in my head. I was like, man, this don't make no sense. Like, how is this fun? I'm spending hours cleaning up and I'm only making this many shirts. Doesn't make no sense. So what I do is I start telling people like, hey, let me make some shirts for you. You know, I could, I'll get some screens done and we'll design it together, this and that. And people are, they're kind of warming up to what I'm doing because now I'm talking about me actually printing. I'm not going to a spot. I'm saying, hey, you could pick it up from my house. I'm going to be printing this and that. So I get a decent size order, and this is, I would say around 2001, 2002 timeframe. And, you know, a lot of people are starting to become rappers. That was just a thing at that time. People started rapping and they wanted their rap group name on some t-shirts. So they're like, you know, we want to get 2 dozen t-shirts made. This is what we want. Black shirts, white print. And at this time, you have to remember the style that was in at the time is like Iceberg is really popular, which is like cartoon characters and pretty expensive shit. Then you had like Rockaware, Sean John. All of these types of brands were starting to, I mean, they were already bubbling, but they were just, going away from t-shirts and they were going into like velour track suits. They were going into full denim suits. So it was like a really weird time in, I don't know if it was just fashion or just in general. T-shirts were still a thing. People were wearing t-shirts, but you have to remember that a lot of people were wearing for brand names now. It wasn't just, I want to wear a cool t-shirt. It was, I want to wear something name brand. I want something that nobody has. And, you know, sneakers are a popular thing. Air Force Ones were a popular thing at this time. Like, this is the era of all of that stuff. Early 2000s, like 2001, 2002, this is what people were wearing. So they're telling me what they want, this crazy design. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I could do that for you. Not a problem. Like, so I price out the t-shirts. I'm talking, you know, I'm doing the 3 for 9s. And I come back with a price just on t-shirts. And they're like, man, that's high. I said, I haven't even told you about what it's going to cost for the screen and for the printing. Because nobody knows this, like, screen printing. Nobody knows production prices. Everybody just understands that you could get t-shirts made, but they don't know what goes into it. So as I'm trying to break down labor and I'm trying to break down, you know, t-shirt prices and print prices and all this stuff, it's going over their head because they don't give a fuck. They just want the t-shirt to be done and go about their day. So going over the numbers, that turned them off and I lost the client right away, right? I pretty much talked myself out of the work. And I was just like, hey, it's going to cost this much for t-shirts. It's going to cost this much for the screens, blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, I don't even have blank screens. I've never coated a screen with emulsion. I don't even know how to burn a screen. I don't have somewhere to burn the screen because I never did it personally. It was always something that Mr. Park did at his shop. So what I did was hit up Mr. Park. I said, hey, man, like, check this out. I'm trying to get these t-shirts done. I'm trying to do this. I need to be able to source everything you got, but on my own. And he said, remember where I told you to buy the screen print station? He said, keep walking up the street. Once you pass the freeway, which is the 10 freeway, he said, there's going to be blank t-shirts, blank everything you could think of walking down there. And he said, if you need more ink, if you need screens, he said, the place that I told you, that area is where you could find all that. He said, you just walk into these businesses and tell them what you're looking for, and that's how you're going to source your shit. I said, oh, damn, all right. I didn't know at the time I was in the fashion district in downtown LA. Like, this is where he sent me. I didn't even know what I was doing, but this is where he sent me to pretty much start this business. You know what I mean? So it was kind of cool. It was a learning experience, but at the same time, I didn't understand what I was doing. I didn't understand the production or just mass producing shit. I thought I knew, but I really didn't. You know what I mean? Because I had 18 screens and I thought I was doing it. But those 18 screens, nobody was really buying the shit. So it was a waste of space. So I went to buy some blank screens, and then they told me that I could actually get rid of the used emulsion on some screens and then recoat them. So this was a big thing because I have 18 screens at home that I can't sell. So now they're telling me I could get some solvents and I could wash away the emulsion and recoat these screens. Boom. So I get a scoop coater. I get photo emulsion. And then what else did I buy? Tape. So they told me I needed tape to tape off the screens, which was cool. And I said, all right, get back. I need to learn how to coat screens. Oh, and I also bought a yellow light bulb. So the light bulb, photo emulsion is what you coat the screens with, right? That's, it's light sensitive. Once the light hits it is when it starts to burn the screen. So I needed somewhere to burn the screens. I had nowhere. So sunlight obviously will activate the emulsion and it will render it useless. I also needed not really a dark room, but somewhere dark enough to burn or coat the screen. And then when I'm ready to burn the screen, same thing. That's where I would handle the screens. I didn't have all these areas in the garage. It was just one big garage door and I had to operate in there. So I got a yellow light bulb because the yellow light bulb didn't activate the photo emulsion. So I did that and I'm trying to use the scoop coater, but you have to have the right finesse with that thing. Like, you put the emulsion in the scoop and then you like kind of graze the screen while you're tipping it over and it's pouring a little bit of emulsion and it's supposed to leave it on there layer, or it's supposed to put it on there nice and even. My shit was crooked. It was like spotty. That's not good. So it takes me a lot of times to practice. I'm using the solvent to clean off the emulsion, all of this stuff. By the time I actually get a decent scoop on it, I'm like, oh damn, like how am I even gonna burn the screen? How am I, like, I don't have nowhere to burn the actual image on the screen. I didn't have vellum. I didn't have a lot of stuff. I was like buying it as I was going. So now that I could coat a screen, it's like, all right, but how do I burn it? I don't have nothing. I don't have, like, he had this little table that was a light table, and it like vacuum sealed this black thing on top, and it shot through, it burned the screen. I didn't have all that. Obviously, I couldn't buy it either. So I went back, instead of going to Mr. Park, I went to downtown LA to where I bought the screen print station. And they're like, oh, you could do it like this. So they told me this easy way to do it with a floodlight on top of like a container, like one of these tote boxes that I have back here. And put the floodlight on there and it'll burn it through. It was a really rinky-dink thing to do, but that's how I was supposed to burn these screens. So for myself, it was learning that, but then also getting the prices for t-shirts down. Because the swap meet, obviously, 3 for $9 sounds like a good deal, right? 3 for $9 is a dope-ass deal, but that's not a wholesale price. So I had to source that. So when I walked down Main Street, downtown LA, in the Fashion District, what I was doing was I was walking to see which door didn't have a little placard that said wholesale only or reseller permit only. I was trying to find one that didn't say it, not knowing that a lot of these places that have that up, they just have it up. But if you're coming in with cash, they'll work with you. You know what I mean? So walked this whole street. I'm talking for like 6 to 8 blocks, and I'm not seeing anybody that's willing to deal with me. I take a shot and I take a chance and I walk into one spot and I'm like, hey, man, like I want to get some AAA t-shirts, which is all style. And I was like, I want to get some AAA t-shirts. I need them in black and white. These are the sizes. The dude was like, all right. So when I told him, I said, you know, I want 3 of this size. I want some of this size, some of this size. He, when I'm telling him 3 and 4 and stuff like that, he's thinking 3 dozen, 4 dozen. So he comes back with this big ass bale of t-shirts. And I was just like, what the hell? And he was like, yeah, this is what you wanted, right? And I said, nah, I'm talking about like 3. I just want 3 of this t-shirt and I want 4 of these. He was like, nah, that's not how this shit works. He was like, you gotta buy by the dozen. Same color, same size, same brand, by the dozen. So I'm like, oh, what the hell? So I'm like, all right, let's do it. What would be the price per? And he was like, oh shit, it'll be like $1.50, $1.75. I'm like, oh shit, if I buy it this way, this is what the price is gonna be. I said, bet, let's do it. So I put in a order with them. I forget how many I order, but I do it, take it home, I'm ready to go, right? Like, I understand wholesale now. I think I understand it. Without having a wholesale permit, I know where I could source shirts. I know where I could get screens. I now have this solvent that could help me reuse some old screens so I could recoat them. I'm in the ball game. Like, let's fucking go, right? And for myself, the harsh reality of having everything ready to go. I have t-shirts stocked up. I have my work area. Everything's clean. And I'm ready to just start doing it. I literally have no clientele. Like, I have nobody that wants to do the shit. And it sucks. I'm going to take a quick break right here. We do have a sponsor. So I'm going to run the sponsor ad. And then we'll get right back into it. Yeah. Yo. Today's episode is going to be brought to you by the good people over at Local Roots Clothing. Now, Local Roots Clothing was kind enough to sponsor this episode right here and bring this podcast to life for everybody. So, if you wanted to rep your roots, make sure you go to localrootsclothing.com. Now, let's get back to the episode. All right, welcome back, everybody. So, what I wanted to actually tell you guys is, when I was doing all of this, I was still in high school, years like 2001, 2002, and I'm still doing my thing on the outside. I'm hustling. I'm no longer working at the skate shop. I'm working in the mall. I'm working at Ladies Foot Locker, actually. So everything that I'm doing up until this point is funded by myself, whether it's coming from hustling, whether it's coming from Lady Foot Locker, whether it's just doing my thing. You know what I mean? I'm I think I was like in the 11th grade, about to be a senior or something like that, or I was already a senior in 2002, somewhere around there. So when I'm looking for work, right? Like, nobody's really coming up to me because everybody's really into wearing brands and everybody's kind of doing their own thing, I guess you could say, right? Everybody's kind of has their own fashion sense. They're really into with quote unquote high-end brands at the time, which Iceberg was really expensive at the time, like $300 jeans and stuff like that. And you had the other people that were still heavily into like Rockaware, Sean John, all of these types of brands also. And then the crazy thing too, out here in Los Angeles, Avericks and Pele Pele coats, leather coats were a big thing. I don't know if it was because rappers were using it or what it was, but it was popular. And the weather out here is always hot. Like, if it's raining, then it's maybe in the 60s. The coldest, 55, somewhere around there. But we have these big leather coats. And it was a crazy time. I don't know, not in fashion, but it was just hip-hop was driving a lot of the fashion around here. And that's just what people were wearing. You know what I mean? It was like Air Force Ones matched whatever shirt you were wearing, matched whatever fitted you were wearing. Pinwheel fitteds were starting to come in. They weren't really that popular yet because jerseys haven't hit yet. But if you were following the trends, you knew what was happening, right? It was like the full denim fit. And then from full denim, it was going to velour tracksuit fits. And then from there, it was going to eventually get into jerseys. That was like the timeline, I guess you could say. So when I was doing this, I had all my stuff ready to print t-shirts. Nobody's really wearing t-shirts like that. They're wearing blank t-shirts, white or black, because a lot of them are wearing jackets over it. They're wearing tracksuit jackets. They're wearing, like I said, denim jackets. They were obviously wearing leather coats out here, which is crazy. So not a lot of people were wearing printed shirts. They were just wearing blank shirts because it was kind of like an undershirt to whatever they were wearing. So in my head, I thought, all right, if I just printed front print stuff that people could wear underneath their jackets, I was going to be in good shape, right? So I just needed to think of some cool shit to put on shirts for people and hopefully get it. So obviously I went to text and different types of fonts that I was creating on my own. I was doing different stuff like that, trying to catch something and just kind of, I don't know, ride the wave, I guess you could say. And so for myself, I was just pretty much coding screens and then testing shit out. You know what I mean? I would code a screen and then I would make, you know, a t-shirt that said, let's just say it said dope or it said fresh and some cool font, and I would wear it to school. Obviously, I would wear it under one of my leather coats or something and trying to be cool, right? So I wear it in school. People see it, but nobody's really asking. And I'm like, man, this shit ain't working for me. What I didn't understand, though, was what I was doing was very basic, but I wasn't marketing it to the right people. You know what I mean? In my head, I was like, I just want to sell to everybody in school. But if I knew what I know now back then, I would have targeted smaller groups and been like, hey, let me make something to match those Air Force Ones that you got. Like, oh shit, you're wearing these crazy ass green and white Air Force Ones. Let me make something that matches those. In my head, I wasn't even thinking that way. I was just mainly trying to sell to everybody. And it was overwhelming me by having all the equipment at home, having the possibilities of making shirts for everybody. That clouded my vision on where I could actually sell. Because at the time, I'm still not even thinking money. I'm thinking money in the terms of printing for other brands. You know what I mean? Mass producing for people, like what Mr. Park was doing. I was trying to hook people up like that. But not everybody was trying to create a brand back then. Nobody was really trying to come up with their own artwork and get shirts made. They were out buying the stuff. You know what I mean? They didn't think about, let me start a business and sell some t-shirts. So that's where I was lost. Like, I had all the equipment. I had everything to go. I was somewhat operational, but I wasn't really doing it just yet. You know what I mean? Like, there was no money coming in. Like I said, I'm working at Lady Foot Locker. I'm coming home and I'm trying to print shirts and trying to create designs. But every design I created, I was trying to burn the screen and start printing already. Whether I'm just making one or two shirts for myself or a homeboy, I was just making one or two. But the setup and cleanup was exactly the same. It took a long ass time to set everything up because I had to burn the screen, put the ink onto the screen, flood it, do all that, and then I had to clean the screen after. And that was reclaiming the ink, using the solvents that stink, and then, you know, clean the screens like Mr. Park told me, where I don't want it to dry up in the screen. So I'm doing all this daily, you know what I mean? And on top of that, hustling, doing my thing also on the side, working at Lady Foot Locker. Obviously, I'm going to school. And all of this time, I'm not thinking of starting a brand. I'm not thinking of anything. I'm thinking of just, I want to make some cool shirts for people. And then I want to be the guy that people come to print their stuff. Now, around this time, I want to say it's 2002 summertime. Like, I graduate high school. It's 2002 summertime. And there's a festival that I go to every single year. Like, I'm talking every year I would go to this festival. It's the one that I vend at Alondra Park here in Los Angeles, Lawndale area, every July. For the people that's come out to see me vend at this and just chop it up, they understand what this thing is. It's a Hawaiian festival, and it's one of the biggest ones in the South Bay, because we don't get that many island festivals here in the South Bay and in the South Bay of Los Angeles. I'm talking like Gardena, Carson, Redondo Beach, Manhattan Beach, Hermosa Beach, all of the surrounding areas, Compton, Wilmington, San Pedro, all of these areas. There's a huge Polynesian presence in this area. Huge. I'm talking from restaurants to like good food, all the way to somebody always knows somebody that's Hawaiian or Samoan or Tongan. You know what I mean? Like, somebody knows somebody, and it's cool. So we have this really big festival that I would attend every single year in July. And I would just go hang out, see family, see friends, vibe, drink, hang out. It was just going just to go. I was not really a customer. Like, I would go to eat and stuff like that, but it was more so just to go and catch up with family and friends out there. So this particular year, 2002, I'm like, oh shit, like, this is coming up. I'll make this cool shirt. It says Island Made, Cali Raised, right? Obviously, majority of the people that are at this festival are islanders, but they all live in Cali. They were born here. And I was like, oh, that'll be cool just to make a shirt for myself to wear to this festival. And I think I made one for my brother or my cousin or something like that. I was like, ah, this will be swell. You know what I mean? I was thinking like, oh, this will be cool, man. So I burn the screen. Obviously, I come up with the text and I come up with everything, the design, and I burn the screen. I get it going. I print these shirts and we wear it to the festival. You know what I mean? It's a Saturday and Sunday thing. I think I wore mine. My brother wore his on Sunday, or my cousin wore it on, I mean, Saturday. I wore mine on Sunday, and it was cool. We got really good reactions. But this is the first time that I thought I need to start a brand, because the reactions that I got when I wore the shirt was crazy. One, I was wearing a shirt that was made for this audience. It was made for the target audience. It was made for the people in this park at this festival at this given time. They're coming from Orange County, San Diego, up north. They're coming from everywhere to this one festival. And this is where I could be making money, right? But I wasn't thinking like that at the time. I was like, I just wanted to make a shirt that was cool for the festival for myself. I was like, oh, ain't nobody gonna wear a shirt like this over here. I wasn't even thinking about, let me make the money off the shit. So I wear it. It's cool. A lot of people hit me up. Hey, where'd you get that shirt? Where can I buy one? Where can I buy one? Bing, light bulb goes off. This is me saying, oh shit, let's fucking go. Let me start making these shirts for these people and start selling them. So, like, on the fly, like, I'm talking like really quick, the first thing I started doing was telling people, like, oh, you know what, you could get it from here. No website, no nothing like that. It was just telling them, I live in Gardena, we can meet up at this popular restaurant that everybody knows, which is Gardena Bowl. It's a bowling alley, but there's a little coffee shop there that sells Hawaiian food. If you are in this area, you understand what Gardena Bowl is, you know the food there, and you go there. So I'm telling people, we could go to Gardena Bowl, you could meet me there next Sunday, next Saturday, whatever, I'll have the shirts. That was just the meetup spot to sell the shirts, and that fucking shit worked. From that point, a whole year goes by of me brainstorming, making shirts for this shit. 2003 comes around, the festival comes around, the shit that I'm ready to do is I don't have a booth. I don't have somewhere to vend in there. It's just me and a lot of my family out there that's going. I fill up coolers, like, you know, your regular cooler to put your drinks in. I fill that up with folded up t-shirts and I roll up into the festival, post up at this tree where my family usually posts up. I'm wearing my shirt, my brother, my cousins, whatever, is wearing them, promoting them. People are asking, hey, where can I buy this shirt? Where can I buy it? You could buy it right here. You could buy it right here. That dude under the tree, he has that cooler. That's where the shirts are. Boom. So I'm fucking making a shitload of money. I think I was selling them for $10 because I'm buying the t-shirts downtown LA. I work out this ill-ass deal with one of the vendors in downtown LA. And I think I'm buying 100 t-shirts at, I think it was $1.25 is what he was going to charge or something like that. So I order 100 t-shirts and he would give me like a $5 discount and just like give me $120 or whatever it was. So I would get the 100 t-shirts, I would print them up, boom. And I was doing this for a little while in preps of selling them. I'm still selling to people at Guardian of Bowl. We're meeting up and it was a cool time because at that time it was, we were doing, everybody had Nextels. Like, I don't remember, I don't know if you remember, like, people chirping each other. This is before Boost Mobile was doing it, but Nextel was a popular thing. So I'm sharing my Nextel code with a lot of people. They're chirping me. I'm like, oh, yeah, preep, I'm over here at Guardian of Bowl. I'm going to be here. People are coming through buying shirts. So I'm doing that throughout the year. And then the festival's coming up. I'm like, oh, I'm going to prepare for this motherfucker. So I end up printing a shitload. Saturday and Sunday, I'm like, oh, I'm just going to keep filling this cooler up, go to the car, put more shirts in. They're going to be selling like hotcakes. What I didn't prepare for was how many shirts we're going to sell. And within that weekend, I think I did like fucking 500 t-shirts or something around that area. And I took a big hit because I did a lot of smalls and mediums. Obviously, Polynesian dudes are huge. People are wearing their stuff baggy back then. So everybody was just buying extra large, double X, triple X. Everybody. Like, I was rarely selling any smalls and mediums. Few larges here and there. But I lost on the smalls and mediums. So I had that dead stock in the car and back home. But everything else was moving. You know what I mean? Extra large, fucking double X, triple X, moving. All I had was t-shirts, no tank tops. I think we did about 500 shirts within that weekend, and that's where I'm like, oh shit, we're actually making money now. Like, we're really making money. So from doing just that, helped me figure out target audience, preparation for stuff, and knowing who you're selling to. So when I tell you guys, hey, you should really know who's going to be there, know your clients, or know your target audience, because it makes for less risk when you're buying shirts, you know what I mean? If your clientele doesn't really fit the small and medium category, save the money on smalls and mediums and put it towards the popular sizes, large, extra large, double X, whatever you offer, you know what I mean? So with doing this, this will eliminate a lot of dead stock, because that's what ultimately cripples a lot of us, is we have shirts that we can't sell, but we have an investment tied into it, right? We already put our money into it, so we kind of have to get that money back. But if it's already printed shirt and you can't sell it, it's dead stock. You know what I mean? You can't move it. So that's what hurts us. So that's why when I always tell you guys, look at the target audience, you know, you understand what sizes they wear. If you're selling stuff to people that go to the gym, obviously a lot of the fitted shirts are going to sell to them because that's what they're into. You know what I mean? So you would know, you know, the mediums and the smalls, they like to wear them a little bit tighter, a little bit more fitted, where the double X's really probably wouldn't sell. You know what I mean? So know your target audience is what I learned doing this. This is early on, 2002, 2003. I knew what type of people were going to be there. Big Polynesian dudes, that's who I was going to be selling to. So the triple X's, double X's, extra larges were the ones I was going to be selling the most of. What I also knew was, the design I created was made for the people at this event. Island made, Cali raised. That, obviously, you're an Islander. You were made by Islander parents, but you were raised in California. So the event is in California, and it's where Islanders go. That's why that simple t-shirt made me a lot of money within that year, and it worked flawlessly. And the crazy shit, not to speed up in the story, but I would say maybe 10 to 11 years later, like 2006, maybe 2000, not 2007, but 2006, I re-released that shirt again, but this time I was in a booth, same festival in a booth. And I made a new rendition of that shirt with the same text that said Island Made Cali Raised. And we sold a shitload of them. But now a lot of the dudes that bought them originally from me when I had them in the cooler, they were like, damn, I remember this shirt. And it was the same people that bought it before, but now I'm in a booth. You know what I mean? So that's just to fast forward a little bit. But I'm going to cut it right here just to let you guys know how this thing worked out. Was myself learning the printing process, but also figuring out my shit, all my equipment, what I needed to do, and then also figuring out what I wanted to do. And that's where I learned that I actually wanted to get into building up brands. I wanted to get out of mass producing for other people and just print for myself. All right. Appreciate everybody for watching and listening in. This was another episode of Bullshitting with Brandoh, BSing with Brandoh. Not sure if we're going to keep that title, but we'll see. Appreciate you guys for watching. Thank you. Catch you guys on the next one. Yeah.